I'm Fremont Community Church and all of my friends out there in Facebook world. It is great to see you this morning on this our third week of Advent. This week the theme is joy, and we are going to light the third candle, which is traditionally pink. It takes a manly man like Jesus to have a pink candle as a part of his celebration. That's what I want to say. But today we are going to celebrate the joy that we find in knowing that God's promises are coming. No question, they're on the way. Let's say our declaration together. We have gathered in the name of Jesus Christ. We have come to this house to worship God. We have come to confess that Jesus is Lord. We are not here to be entertained. We are here to encounter the sacred. We are not consumers, we are worshipers. We praise and adore the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Father, we do thank you for this morning. A little gloomy outside, but here we are in your presence, together digitally once again. Hopefully for the last time. Lord, I've been praying all morning and since last night that you would do something tonight, today, this morning. Or that you would
thank you, Jesus.
Do things that only you can do.
Yes, God.
This would go beyond church and beyond tradition. And that there would be an encounter with the divine. Speak to human hearts this morning, we ask. In Jesus' name.
blessing for all that you've done for me.
Thank you.
the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Oh Jesus Christ, my living.
Could fathom such boundless grace. The God of ages, he stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls.
My living hope. You are living.
I thank you for this morning, that we have a living hope, anchored within the veil, seated at the right hand of the Father on high, ever living to make intercession for us. Lord, you are so good. You are so good. And this morning, we choose joy this morning. We choose joy this morning. We choose joy this morning, Lord. Because your promises are true. Because you never change. Rejoice, we will rejoice, we will rejoice. We love you, Lord.
Hey, Fremont family. I just wanted to take a second to say hi virtually, first of all. And second of all, I wanted to remind you guys that we typically take up an offering for Josh and Rachel. Shh, don't tell. And for Christmas time, and because of how everything has been happening with being shut down, it's been a little bit difficult to do that. So I just wanted to ask you to consider giving, and if you are willing to give, that you would send a check to the church and earmark it for Josh and Rachel. And you can give online. There is an actual button for the pastoral Christmas gift, I believe is how it's marked. Anyway, I just wanted to ask you to do that. I hope you all are doing well, and I can't wait to see your faces next week. Hopefully and prayerfully, we will be up and going then. God bless.
Well, welcome back, Fremont Community Church, my friends out there on the interwebs. It is great, really great, to be with you on this third week of Advent. I do want to say this. We are going to, unless the government shuts everything down completely, our plan is to be back in the building face-to-face next Sunday, 7 days from now, 10 a.m. I want to celebrate that Sunday of Christmas with you face to face. But I also want to say this to you. Our county is still red in the numbers, okay? Which means that there's a whole lot of COVID around, all right? So I'm saying this to you. We need to be absolutely careful, and we need to wear our masks, and we're going to be especially careful about social distancing on Sunday. But I can't stand another Sunday without seeing your faces. So we're going to meet together again, unless Governor Holcomb makes some other decision. We are not going to be having childcare next week, but We'll join together as families, and you can sit together in your family groups. And we unfortunately, no hugging or shaking hands or any of that. I would love to do that. I'd love to give all of you a big hug. And that day is coming, I hope and pray. But it won't be next Sunday, okay? So join us at Fremont Community Church next Sunday. If you're feeling ill, or if you just don't feel like you can be in a public space like that next Sunday, we will still be going live as we do every Sunday, so you can join us that way. But I wanted to put that out there. Okay, this is the third week of Advent. I want to pray, and then we'll dive into our scripture for this morning. Precious Heavenly Father, I thank you so much. You are good, and your mercy endures forever. And your presence is so precious and so beautiful. Your love never changes. You are with us. You never leave us. You never forsake us. Whenever we gather together, you are here in the midst with us every time. Lord, I know that as we dive into this word this morning, these stories this morning that we are going to tell, that you have things that you want us to hear. You have things to say to us. So, Lord, I ask in the name of Jesus that our hearts would be open to hear what you have to say, that our hearts would be melted by your Holy Spirit, and that we would receive the good news that you have for us today in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Okay, so week three of Advent is the week where we contemplate joy. And I think that's really, really great. Of course, everybody loves to be joyful. But because it's Advent, and because this Advent is very different than every other Advent, we have to look more deeply at this thing we call joy. We have to spend more time with it. We have to chew on it. Now, as I don't know how many of you have been joining me every weekday on Facebook for those, I've been posting Advent devotionals every day. But I personally have been deeply ministered to by God's word especially in this last week, this week of contemplating preparation and what it means to live in a place of peace and preparation before the Lord as we wait for what he is going to do. And I want to invite you once again to join us there. They will be going out. They usually go out very early in the morning because I do them the day before and schedule them to post at like 1:30 in the morning. So they should be, whenever you wake up, they should be there. They're short. It shouldn't take you 5 minutes to read them. But just put us in a place of contemplation and in a place where we're preparing our hearts. And in this week, we're going to focus on the story of the Annunciation. Now, that's a word that we don't use so much in our Protestant circles. But the Annunciation is the event in the Gospels where Mary is informed by the angel Gabriel that she will be the mother of Messiah. And there's actually kind of a series of events that take place. There is the actual Annunciation from Gabriel to Mary that she is going to bear the child and that that child's father will be God. But then there is the second event, and the second event is really where we're going to focus this morning, which is Mary is told by the angel that her cousin, Elizabeth, who is older, she's well along in years. The Bible says we don't know how long that is, but she's beyond childbearing years, and she did not bear any children when she was in childbearing years. And now, out of nowhere, seemingly, she is pregnant. And that is to be a sign to Mary that everything she heard from the angel is the truth. So Mary pulls her things together, and she goes to where Elizabeth is. Now we know that Elizabeth is bearing John the Baptist, that John the Baptist is the baby in her womb, and that he is the one that prepares the way for Jesus. But Mary didn't know anything about that. And Mary goes to visit her cousin to see if what the angel has told her is the truth. And when she gets there, the minute that she walks in the door, you can find this story in Luke chapter 1, the minute that she walks in the door, the child Elizabeth was 6 months along, so the baby would have been moving. But the minute that she walks in the door and she greets her cousin Elizabeth, "Hey, Liz," or whatever, I don't know, who knows what they call each other. but, you know, soon as she greets her cousin Elizabeth, the child in Elizabeth's womb, future John the Baptist, leaps inside of her. And Elizabeth has the Holy Spirit come upon her. And Elizabeth makes this stunning prophetic declaration about Mary and the child that's in Mary's womb at this time. And it's very possible that no one even knew that Mary was pregnant at this time except for Mary. She wouldn't have been quick to tell people because she was not a married woman. And so she would have probably hidden it as long as she could. And so Elizabeth did for certain, or I would say probably for certain, did not know that Mary was pregnant. But all of a sudden, Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Spirit, says to Mary, "Oh, blessed are you, and the mother of my Lord," right? She makes this incredible prophetic declaration over Mary, and Mary sees that Elizabeth is pregnant, and there's this thing that happens where Mary, all of a sudden, it becomes incredibly real to her that everything that Gabriel has said to her is the truth, that she is bearing a child, and that child is the child of God, the Son of God, and the Savior of the world. And to continue the Pentecostal Holy Ghost party, Mary now gets filled with the Holy Spirit, and she begins to sing a spontaneous song. See, Bethel did not make those up. Those have been around for a long time. And Mary begins to sing a spontaneous song under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, which we have, the church in traditionally has called the Magnificat, okay? And I'm going to read it to you. It's from Luke chapter 1, verse 46 and following, which we'll put actually on the screen for you so you can read along. You have to go, there's a lot of slides. So. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy. As he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and to his offspring forever," and Mary remained with her about 3 months and then returned to her home. Mary was having a moment that we have a phrase for this moment, okay? It's the moment when reality hits, okay? The phrase that we use is the penny has dropped. I don't know if that's a phrase you're familiar with. It comes from the old days when vending machines actually took pennies, right? You could put pennies in it, but sometimes the mechanism didn't work quite right, so you had to hit it a few times, and then the penny would finally click, 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 drop down, right? You've all experienced this, maybe not with pennies, but with a coin that you put into a vending machine, and you're like, what's going on? And it's at the moment the penny drops that the vending machine will give you whatever it was that you had, you know, tried to buy from the vending machine. It's like, that is a euphemism. It's a description of this moment when I knew it was true. I already had an intellectual understanding of the truth, but now it feels true. And we all know the difference. I remember when Isaac was born. We went through, Rachel had to deliver by emergency C-section. It was kind of, and we weren't expecting anything to happen for several days before that. And she went into the doctor's office and they said, it has to be now. And they took her in. And so it was this whole whirlwind of unexpected events. And then all of a sudden, Isaac's in the world. And even being with them there in the hospital and spending time with Rachel and with Isaac and whatever was wonderful and just awesome, but it all felt like a dream. It all felt like something separate from my real life. You know, it all felt like maybe it wasn't exactly real. But when we brought Isaac outside in that little car seat and I buckled him into the back seat of the car, that's when the penny dropped for me that my life was never going to be the same. And in so many wonderful, incredible ways. Although I will say that the thought that ran through my head was, I'm never getting rid of this kid. Like this is just, you know, I love you, Isaac. But my life was irrevocably changed. And that it wasn't until that moment. I mean, we had been through the whole pregnancy. Of course, we'd seen the sonogram, all that stuff. But it wasn't until that moment when here it is, me and Rachel and Isaac, and we're a family, and that's the way it's going to be forever. That things really came alive to me, that this is the way things are going to be. Mm-hmm. And that's the kind of moment that I see with Mary in this moment, that she had this weird encounter with this guy and she feels a little different. Maybe there's some morning sickness coming on. Who knows where she is in the whole pregnancy thing. We don't know how long it was between the time that Mary got spoken to by the angel and the time that she went to visit Elizabeth, but we don't think it was very long, maybe just a couple of days. And she's probably really wondering, is this actually true? Is this really happening? Like, is this for real? Like pinching herself. And maybe she didn't even really know how to feel about it, because an unwed woman with a child, I mean, there were arguments in Jewish law that she should be stoned. What were people going to think? But now as she walks into her cousin's house and she sees that she's pregnant and the Holy Spirit moves on Elizabeth to make this declaration, and then the Holy Spirit lands on Mary and she begins to exclaim and to realize exactly what has happened. That was the moment where she had a choice to make, you see, because news like that, life-altering news, when I locked my infant son in the back seat of the car, we get to decide what our emotional response to that moment is going to be. We can believe that good things are coming, that God is faithful, that God is doing something unbelievable, and that he has beautiful plans for our future and that we are walking in partnership with him. Or we can lapse back into anxiety and fear. What am I going to do now? How am I going to take care of this? How am I going to take care of that? But it is a choice. It is a decision that we make, whether to pull ourselves into protective mode and say, I'm not sure how to feel about this, or to allow ourselves to relax and to believe and to trust and to celebrate. You see, there is a verb, okay? That's an action word that exists in the English language that we don't really use. And it's because we don't understand that sometimes joy is a choice to make. And that verb is the verb rejoice. And that word rejoice means to be joyful. It is a decision that is made. I am going to rejoice. I am going to be joyful. I am choosing to be joyful. Yeah. Now, I do not want to make anyone who's walking through sadness, difficulty, or depression feel like I'm accusing you of you're not choosing to be joyful. Oh my goodness. I have been there. I have been in times of real anxiety and real depression where I couldn't control my own emotions. I didn't have any understanding. But even in those places, rejoicing is still an option. Because rejoicing isn't about how we feel. It's about what we're choosing to believe about what is going to take place. Mm-hmm. And the thing that we need to understand is that very, very often, the choice to rejoice, I didn't mean to rhyme it like that, I promise. I am not that kind of preacher. But the choosing to rejoice is what precedes joy. It begins our journey toward joy. Because we can choose, like last week we talked about repenting from despair. Mm-hmm. And this week we're talking about choosing to rejoice. And that's all in the same motion. You know what? I am not going to wallow in that place of fear, of worry, and of being paralyzed by circumstances that I don't understand. I am going to choose to believe that God is up to something good. That's a good old song for those of you. written by Nancy Honeytree, I believe, who's a friend. Anyway, but we are choosing to rejoice. Yeah. We are choosing to believe that God is up to something good, even when we can't see it yet, even though we only have the first inklings. And Mary it has been proven to her beyond any reasonable doubt that Jesus is on his way. And she could have believed anything she wanted to about this child. Now, the angel told her that some things about this baby that was coming, but just because she heard that does not mean, and then Elizabeth also told her some things about this child that was to come, but that doesn't mean she has to believe it. A lot of times we have trouble believing the testimony of people, even when they're extremely trustworthy, like Gabriel the archangel, okay? Look at Zechariah. He had trouble believing Gabriel's words too, and that's why he got struck dumb until the baby came, okay? But Mary is here, and she has this decision to make. She can either worry or she can rejoice. And rejoicing is the choice that faith makes. And rejoicing is the choice that we're making on the third week of Advent. We're choosing joy. We're choosing to rejoice. We're choosing to believe that God is doing something, even when we can't see it, even when we don't understand it, even when it looks different than we thought that it would. This was not the plan Mary had for her life. But she began to believe, and as she began to rejoice, she began to see, maybe through the scriptures, maybe through the things that the angel told her, maybe through what Elizabeth told her, but she began to see that this wasn't just about her. Mm-hmm. She began to see that what God was doing in her, he was doing for the whole world. That God was overturning the system of this world, and God was establishing a new kingdom, a kingdom of love and kindness and fairness, a kingdom where might no longer made right, a kingdom where one is not going to be highly privileged over another, a kingdom where there was true fairness, a kingdom that was different than any kingdom, the very kingdom that had been prophesied by Israel's ancient prophets. I want to show you a picture. Can I do that? This is a picture that was drawn back in 2003. And it's called Mary Consoles Eve. And I'm just going to leave it on the screen for a while. Because every time I look at this picture, I get misty. I get stirred. There's so much to say about this beautiful picture. We have Eve on the left, still clutching the apple with the bite taken out of it. with the serpent wrapped around her feet. And you can see that she is sad. She's in mourning. She is hurt and broken by what has happened, by what she's done. And here comes Mary, very pregnant with Jesus. And she's taking Eve's hand and she's putting it on her stomach. And she's holding Eve's head in that consoling way. And she is crushing the head of the serpent with her left foot. I love that so much. Because here in Mary is the answer to the brokenness that began so long ago. Here in Mary, the mourning of Eve can be brought to an end. Here in Mary, joy is restored to the human race. God has seen and God has answered the deep brokenness of humanity, and growing inside the womb of this teenage Jewish girl is the one who will overturn completely and forever the power of death and hell and sin and the grave. Mary, in this moment, you can take that off the screen now. Mary, in this moment, is choosing to see exactly what God is doing, and she's choosing to believe that here in her own womb is the possibility that God is ending the power of death forever, that God is overturning the power of sin, that God has finally, after all this time, taken the action, the final action that was needed to change the entire nature of the universe from death and decay to life and resurrection. Mm-hmm. And she sees that going on in her heart. Many years later, Jesus himself went to his hometown in Nazareth. And he goes to his hometown synagogue, the place where he had undoubtedly been taught how to read the Hebrew letters, the place where he had undoubtedly spent time studying with the other Jewish boys of his time, learning how to read the Word of God. Isn't that fascinating? The Word of God, learning how to read the Word of God. What a powerful thing. Yeah. And he stands in that place among people who knew him, among people who probably, maybe they thought he was a little different, but for the most part, they just thought of him as another kid from our town. And he asks for the scroll because the big rabbi has come home, right? And they've invited him to speak in his home pulpit. And he asks for the scroll of Isaiah. He turns to Isaiah chapter 61 and he reads. I put it on there last night. It's not on there. Oh, you can go there. Yeah, I put the Luke, the passage in Luke where Jesus read it, but it comes from Isaiah chapter 61. And he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as was his custom, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him, and he unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written. It's Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down, and the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." Their response was quite different from Mary's. their response was entirely different from Mary's. When Mary heard the prophetic word that God was going to do what he had been promising for centuries to do, and in her own womb, she chose to rejoice. She chose to believe. She chose to say yes. She chose to be a partner with God in doing what God wanted to do to change the whole world.
Yes.
The people in Nazareth did not have that response. The people in Nazareth began to ask questions. Isn't this Joseph's boy? Don't we know this kid? Don't his sisters still live here? This guy, what is he saying? The scripture has been fulfilled in his reading. And they got very, very angry with Jesus. And it says Jesus was not able to do any miracles there in Nazareth. Why? Because they could not believe in his message. This is where Jesus says that famous line, "A prophet is not without honor except in his hometown." The reason I read this to you, number one, it's one of our Advent readings for today. But number two, is because of the incredibly stark difference between Mary's response to the proclamation of the good news and the people in Nazareth's response to the proclamation of good news. Mary chose to rejoice. The people of Nazareth chose to be critical and not to believe. And the same choice lies before you today on this third Sunday of Advent 2020. Probably for most of you, one of the worst years in your own memory. I'm here and I'm saying to you, God is up to something good. In this moment, at this time in your life, that within you, there is a process that has begun that is going to bring about a beautiful thing, not just for you, but for the people around you. And that process, that thing that is alive in you, is called the kingdom of God. And you have a choice this morning. Are you going to choose Mary's way, rejoice and believe and bear the Messiah, carry him into the world? Or are you going to choose the Nazareth way? To not believe, to leave it behind, to get critical, and to harm the mission of Messiah? That's the question. What are you going to do? Let's pray. Glorious Heavenly Father, you speak good news to us every day, even in the midst of difficult times. And this morning, this morning, oh God, we choose to believe that the kingdom of God is alive inside of us. Lord, I pray for my friends. I choose to believe that the kingdom of God is alive inside of me, and that what God is doing inside my heart can flow out to change the entire world, to change. If I will just say yes, if I will just choose to rejoice, if I will just believe that you, God, are capable of taking humble, broken little me and bringing something beautiful into the world. Lord, if I will just believe, I will see.
Yes. Amen.
Lord, I make that choice and I pray for my friends. Lord, I ask you to give them the grace to choose Mary's response and not the response of Nazareth. I ask you, Lord, to give them the grace to say yes to the promises you speak over them. But I pray over all of us, no matter where we're found this morning, that we would hear the good news. Mm-hmm. That Jesus died for us, and in dying defeated sin and death.
Thank you,
Jesus. Forever. And has freed us and empowered us by his Holy Spirit to truly love God and to truly love each other. Lord, do beautiful things in us and through us this week, we pray. Amen and amen. I'm looking forward to seeing you next week. God bless you. We love you. If you have any prayer requests, send them our way. I'd love to pray for you. I do want to encourage you to give to Fremont Community Church, to continue to stay faithful in that way.
You can go to the website, fremontcommunity.org, or you can send a check to the church. We love you. Have a great day.